Hey folks, welcome to Digimento Education. This is Electronic Devices and Circuits Lecture 16. I'm a course instructor, Utkarsh Upadhyay. Hopefully, you must have gone through all the lectures that I covered before and are well versed with the concepts. Okay, so it is very much required for you guys to be well versed with all the concepts, otherwise you won't be able to solve or any of the questions thrown to you in the examination. Okay, so if you really like the video, please hit the like button, share and subscribe to our channel and write down your comments below in the comment section. In the last lecture, we ended our discussion with the concentration of injected majority charge carriers on either side of the p-n junction at the edge of the depletion region. Okay, now in this lecture we are going to start with a new expression that represents the forward current of the diode, the forward current across the diode. Okay, so let's write down the heading: forward current across the diode. Okay, इसके बारे में अब हम discuss करते हैं. हमने जो initially expression देखा था forward current का, so we saw that forward current is equal to IF is equal to IS e to the power V D by eta Vt minus 1. Or if this expression is very large, we can approximate it, this expression to this particular expression, Vd by eta Vt. We basically saw this thing. Now what is saturation current? So saturation, this forward current comes out to be equal to Aq dp Pn0 upon Lp plus Aq dn Np0 upon ln e to the power Vd by eta Vt minus 1. So this is basically the actual expression of the forward current across the diode. Okay, understand? Where A is the area of cross section, Q is the electronic charge, dp is basically diffusion constant of hole, Pn0 concentration of holes in the N region, Lp is basically the diffusion length of the holes in the N region, A is area cross section, Q is the electronic charge, Dn is a diffusion constant of electrons in the P region, Np0 is the concentration of holes in the concentration of electrons in the P region, Ln is the diffusion length of electrons in the P region. Okay, so this is, we can, from here we can conclude that your reverse saturation current IS or the leakage current is equal to Aq dp Pn0 upon Lp plus Aq dn Np0 upon Ln. This is very important expression. Many a times it has happened that some questions related to this particular expression has been thrown, some questions related to this particular expression have been thrown to the students in the examination, ranging from the theoretical expression to the practical numerical question. So it is very much important. This expression has got an utmost importance, and it is required for you to give an equal weightage to this particular expression. And it is your duty to remember this expression for your whole life. Okay, as soon so this expression is important, because is question se, is expression se aapko theoretical or practical numerical questions puche ja sakte hain. Okay, so we can make further modification in the expression. IF is equal to A into Q dp. What is Pn0 is Ni square by Nd. So it's equal to Lp into Nd plus Q Dn upon Ln into Na N I square e to the power Vd by eta Vt minus 1. Okay? So, this is basically due to holes from P to N, and this is due to electrons from N to P. Understand? So, forward current density. Now, forward current density how can we represent forward current density? We can represent it by JF. So JF will be equal to IF by A, IF upon area. This will be equal to Q DP upon LP ND plus Q DN upon LN into NA NI square e to the power VD by eta VT minus 1. Understand? So this is the these are some important formulas that you need to remember. Okay, so from here we can say that reverse saturation current is proportional to Ni square. Just we just saw, okay, we just saw that Is is basically proportional to Ni square. And what Ni square is proportional to? Ni square is proportional to T to the power 3. Now as Ni square is proportional to T to the power 3, this implies that Is is proportional to T cube, which means that Is increases with increase in temperature. So Is is highly sensitive to temperature. So there are two expressions which basically determine the change in the current with respect to the change in temperature. We saw that Is is equals to at temperature T2 is equal to Is T0 e to the 2 to the power T2 minus T1 upon 10. And this is the new expression which shows the dependency of Is over temperature. So Is is highly sensitive to temperature. Okay. Let's have a look at some examples based on this concept. Now let's have a look at this question. A diode D under certain biasing conditions, the voltage VD1 is equal to 0.7 volt and ID1 is 5.6 milliampere. Under the same external conditions, another diode D2 where the doping levels Na and ND are both twice when compared to D1 and has the same forward voltage drop VD2 is equal to 0.7 volt. Assuming the same utility factor is eta for both the diodes, then ID2 will be what? So in this case you just need to consider the dependency of the forward current over the doping concentrations, because everything else is constant for both the diodes. So we know that your forward current is somewhat equal to A times Q into DN upon LN into NA plus Q into DP upon LP into ND and so on and so forth. And there's some expression VD by eta VT minus 1, something like that. Okay, that's a random expression. This is and also an I square. Okay, so this is basically the expression that we basically ran across a few minutes before. So we can say that IF is inversely proportional to the doping concentration. Okay, so IF2 will be equal to what? So we can say that both the doping levels are doubled as compared to that in the case of the diode D1. So we can say that if we just multiply the denominator by 2 and 2, IF2 will be equal to IF1 by 2. Because IF1 is, let's say this is basically your IF1. IF2 will be equal to 2 times of NA, 2 times of ND. Everything else will remain constant because VD is also constant, eta is constant, VT is constant, NI square is also constant for both the diodes, A is constant for both the diodes because nothing is mentioned about it. So IF2 will be equal to IF1 by 2, this will be 5.6 by 2, this will be equal to 2.8 milliampere. So answer will be equal to B. So this is the answer. Let's have a look at one more example. Okay, now let's have a look at this particular example. For a silicon diode with the long P and N regions, the accepted and donor impurity concentrations are 10 to the power 17 atoms per centimeter cube and 10 to the power 15 atoms per centimeter cube respectively. Lifetime, so what are the things that we are available with? Let's just jog them down. We know NA, we know ND, 10 to the power 15 per centimeter cube. We know tau n is the electron carrier lifetime, which is given in this case is 100 microseconds. So this is 100 microsecond, which is equal to tau p as well. Dn is a diffusion constant, is 49 centimeter square per second, and dp is given to us as 36 centimeter square per second. Okay, your VD, the forward voltage of 28 millivolt is applied across it. Millivolt. We need to find out the hole current density. We need to find out JP. Okay, we know this. All these things we can find out. Now let's find out ln. Ln will be equal to mu n VT. So this will be equal to dn into tau n. So dn will be equal to mu n vt tau n. So this will be equal to 4900. Okay, because tau n, we know tau n, we know dn as well. This will be equal to 0.07 centimeter. Understand? Now what is lp? Lp will be equal to square root of dp into tau p. This will be equal to square root dp, 36 into tau p. Tau p is also 100 microsecond. From here we get 0.06 centimeter. Okay, as we know these things, we need to find out JP. JP will be equal to Q into dp into ni square over lp into nd e to the power vd by eta vt minus 1, because we just saw the expression of the overall current density, overall current or overall forward current density, okay, which is basically a combination of both electron current density and hole current density. So we have only considered the hole forward current density. Okay, this is basically your JFP by A. So we are not incorporating area in this expression because already coming into the denominator. So this will be equal to Q. Let's modify this expression a bit further. So this will be called Q and I square and D square root of dp upon tau p e to the power vd by eta vt minus 1. Okay, so since we know ln and lp, we can just plug this thing in, plus these all these values in, into minus 19 into 10 to the power 20 divided by nd, 10 to the power 15, square root of 36 divided by 100 into 10 to the power minus 6 into e to the power 208 millivolt upon 2 into 26, because we know the utility factor of for silicon is 2 minus 1. Okay, so if we solve for this thing, you get 0.51456 nanoampere per centimeter square. So this is the current, this is basically the whole current density. Okay, understand? Now there are some two examples which basically will be enough to clear the concepts. For solving more problems, you can refer to The gate we could refer to the some gate books which basically consist of multiple questions asked in the gate examination, in the PSU examination or in the IES examination. Now let's discuss in detail about the variation in the forward voltage across the diode with the temperature. Okay, so this is basically a forward voltage across the diode. Okay, we know the expression of the forward current, which basically is somehow exponentially related to the forward voltage. If we just basically neglect minus 1 and take the natural log on both the sides and rearrange the equation, we get Vd is equal to eta Vt ln If by Is. Since we know that If is basically your Is e to the power Vd by eta Vt, we know this is the sort of relation, so we basically have applied a natural log on both the sides and rearranged the equation. Now this expression seems to be a bit familiar to us when we basically wrote down the built-in potential at the junction of the PN junction diode. That was somewhat equal to V naught is equal to Vt ln NAND by Ni square. And we saw that as we increase the temperature, the built-in potential decreases by 2.5 millivolt. The same logic applies also here. So forward decreases with, so in this case we can say that forward voltage drop across the diode decreases with temperature. Okay, understand? So for every 1 degree Celsius rise in temperature, Vd decreases by 2.5 millivolt. Okay, understand? Okay, so basically the injected minority carrier concentration in a PA plus junction, let's draw the diffusion profile of the injected majority charge carriers on either side of the PN junction. Okay, so the injected minority carriers, the injected minority carriers concentration in a P plus N junction diode when under forward biasing is shown below. Okay, let's have a look at the diffusion profile. Let's say this is basically the y-axis and this is the x-axis. Let's say this is basically the depletion width. W represents the depletion width. Okay, so the electrons are basically injected into the P side. Let's say this is basically your P type and this is basically your N type. Since it's a P plus N junction, so the depletion width will be more towards N side. Okay, so from here, let's say this is WP, this is basically your WN. So this is basically P plus type, so of course WP will be less than WN. Understand? Electrons from here will basically jump into the P type in the P region, and the holes will basically go from P region to the N region. It will be something like this. Now let's draw the diffusion profile. So as soon as the electrons enter into the P region, they start, they basically diffuse across the length of the P type of the P plus region. So the diffusion profile of the electrons under forward biasing is something like this in the P plus type region. Okay, this is basically the diffusion profile. Diffusion profile. This is basically your diffusion profile. So this is basically the other injected electron concentration. And when the holes enter into the N region, they also, because of the concentration gradient, diffuse across the length of the N plus region. Okay, so this is basically injected hole concentration. Understand? Okay, now let's basically have a look at another topic, another very important topic is the VI characteristics of the diode. And you know that this particular topic is very, very favorite of the interviewers sitting there to basically trick you, knock you down if you are not well versed with these characteristics. Okay, the questions that basically arise from this particular topic are very pat to the interviewers, and they, if you are going for a VLSI profile or something related to analog, it's highly probable that the interviewer may ask you some questions based on this particular topic on VI characteristics. So it's very important that you understand each and every ounce of what I'm going to teach you right now. So otherwise you will have to face a hell lot of problems during the interview. And many a times it has happened that questions have basically popped up in the examination from this particular topic. Okay, now let's basically go through this the lecture. This particular topic is also, it is very important. The VI characteristics are very important, and this, and being an engineer, being, if you want to get into an VLSI domain, you should know the VI characteristics of a diode. That's so basic. Okay, it's simple and basic yet important. Let's say this is plus VD and the forward current flows in this particular direction. So forward current, forward characteristics of a diode looks something like this. So keenly observe the forward characteristics. It's in milliampere. Just keep in mind that the diode cannot bear large currents. That's basically in the order of ampere. This is basically your forward voltage VD. So we are drawing the IV characteristics. So if we want to calculate, if you are basically performing the piecewise analysis of this particular of the diode characteristics, the diode becomes linear. Okay, and if you want to calculate the piecewise resistance of the diode, then you have to consider a particular chunk of the graph, and the reverse of the inverse of that of the slope of the characteristics will give you the resistance. So it's something like this. So diode will not function when it is forward biased. I already told you that the diode will not function until the until the applied external voltage becomes equal to the cut-in voltage of the diode. When your external voltage becomes equal to the built-in potential of the diode. Okay, so this is basically here we represent it by V gamma. This is the cut-in voltage, and there is an after that there is an exponential relation of the forward current with the external voltage. Okay, this is V gamma, and okay, and when we apply a reverse voltage across the diode, if you are considering when you apply the reverse biasing across the diode, and if you are considering it to be an ideal diode, so ideally the current will be equal to zero across the diode, because reverse saturation current is neglected when we consider the diode to be ideal. Else when we consider it to be a practical diode or a non-ideal diode, the reverse current will be equal to reverse saturation current. So it will be something like this. This will be equal to minus IS. This is a reverse saturation current. And this is a particular voltage which is basically a breakdown region. So if we apply the reverse bias voltage greater in magnitude, greater than the reverse bias voltage in magnitude, then the diode will destroy. So we have to keep in mind that the reverse biasing voltage that you apply across the diode should be less than the breakdown voltage of the diode in magnitude. So this is minus I, which is in microamperes. Okay, this is basically microamperes for germanium diode, or you can say it's a nanoampere for silicon diode, because we know the reverse saturation current in germanium diode is greater than the silicon diode. Okay, this will be equal to minus IS. If we just have a look at the characteristics of germanium diode, we know the cut-in voltage of a germanium diode is equal to 0.2 volts. So this is basically for germanium diode. It will look something like this. This is basically your forward current. This is the applied voltage. And this characteristics look something like this. This is V gamma, and this is equal to 0.2 volt. This forward voltage cannot be greater than 0.5 volt, as I already told you before. And for silicon diode, it's like this. This is forward voltage. This is a drop. This is V cut-in. This is basically equal to 0.7 volt. And it's like this. This is basically your 0.9 volt. Understand? So larger current in germanium diode than in silicon diode. This is the point that you need to know. For gallium arsenide, this is basically a direct band gap semiconductor. V gamma is basically 1.3 volt, and the maximum forward voltage that you can apply is equal to 3.3 volt. So the characteristics look something like this. This is 1.3 volt, and then it increases. It cannot go beyond 3.3 volt. Okay? Understand? Okay. So just to conclude these characteristics into one sentence, we can say that diode is a non-linear device. If somebody asks you whether the diode is a linear device or a non-linear device, you have to say diode is a non-linear device, or you can say and unidirectional. But the next question arises whether it is an active device or a passive device. So it's important to note down that diode can be active or passive depending upon the applications. Okay. Now, let's talk of the diode resistance. Diode resistance. Now, there are two types of diode resistance. First one is basically forward resistance. Forward resistance and reverse resistance. Okay. Understand? Now, forward resistance basically varies from 10 ohm to 100 ohm. Okay. And there are two type of resistances. First one is basically your DC resistance, and second one is basically your AC resistance. Okay, or you can say It's a dynamic resistance. Okay, so, and this can be your static resistance. DC or static or AC or dynamic. Reverse resistance is of the order of mega ohms. So, we represent it by RR is greater than or equal to 1 mega ohm. Because in when reverse biasing is applied across the diode, the current is very, very small. It's in microamperes, it is either in microamperes or in nanoamperes. So, I naught increases with temperature. As we know, the reverse saturation current increases with the temperature. So, we can conclude that reverse resistance decreases with the temperature. Okay, so with increase in temperature, your reverse saturation current increases. And so, which basically tacitly says that reverse resistance decreases with temperature. This is important. The relationship between the reverse resistance and the temperature. Understand? Now, let's have a look at the equivalent representation of the diode. Okay? The equivalent circuit representation of the diode. So, how can we represent the diode? So, first let's write down the first case when the diode is forward biased. Okay, when the diode is forward biased, so how would you represent the diode in order to solve the questions? Okay, so let's say this is the diode, p-n junction diode. This is forward biased. Okay, this is forward biased. We can represent the diode with, this is basically a non-ideal. We are considering it to be non-ideal diode. Okay, this is basically a non-ideal diode. Okay, so this is basically equivalent to the series combination of ideal diode, a forward resistance, which is basically your RF, and the cut-in voltage V gamma. Since it is forward biased, we can consider ideal diodes as a short circuit. We can consider it to be a short circuit. Understand? So this is how it is represented, or you can basically directly represent it as a combination of forward resistance and the cut-in voltage. So, when you will basically encounter some questions, when you will study your analog circuits, you will have to solve many questions related to clippers and clampers, which basically would incorporate the approximate representation of the equivalent representation of a non-ideal diode, of which you will be given the forward resistance and the cut-in voltages. So, first of all, the first thing that you need to do is to represent the diode with the combination of these three. And after that, when we basically find out that if the diode is in forward bias, we have to represent it with the short circuit, and if the diode is in reverse bias, we have to represent it with the open circuit. So this is basically the forward when the diode is forward biased. Okay, when RF is not given, if RF is not given, then the representation is just this, V gamma. If gamma is also not given, then diode is ideal, and the equivalent representation is a short circuit. Understand? Now, when the diode is reverse biased. Now let's have a look when the diode is reverse biased. Okay, so let's have a look at that. This is a PN junction diode. When the diode is reverse biased, the equivalent representation will be only a reverse resistance RR, which is greater than or equal to 1 mega ohm. Okay, if RR is not given, then the diode, when the diode is ideal and equivalent representation is an open circuit. Okay, this is how it goes. Okay, I think this must be clear to you. How do we represent the diodes into two different biasing conditions? Okay, in order to solve the questions. So as I basically wrote down one important line, the diode is basically non-ideal and can be active or passive depending upon the applications. So when the diode is forward biased, it is active because it is equivalent to the series combination of an active element, this is active element, and a passive element. Resistor is basically a passive element. Your cut in voltage is basically an active element. So when the diode is forward biased, it is active. But when the diode is reverse biased, it's passive. As you can see, it's only represented with the reverse resistance, RR. Okay. And if we consider Zener diode, when it is operated in the breakdown region, it basically acts as a series combination. It's basically equivalent to the series combination of the reverse resistance, or you can say the breakdown resistance, and the breakdown voltage. So that's why it will act as an active element when the Zener diode is operated in the breakdown region. Okay, now let's move our attention towards the discussion of the junction capacitance. Junction capacitance. This also has got hell lot of importance, and you can expect multiple questions to be asked you in the examination or in the interviews. So wherever we are discussing about the charges, we are discussing about the flow of the charges under a constant biasing conditions, under a certain biasing conditions. So of course there will be some sort of capacitance developed across the junction of the PN junction diode. So let's say this is basically a PN junction diode sample. Okay, this is basically your depletion region. So this is negative immobile ions, this is positive immobile ions, this is p-type, and this is n-type semiconductor, this is W width, and the other two terminals of the diode. So since there are immobile ions present about the PN junction, so they will be at some junction capacitance which is represented by CJ. The CJ is basically equal to A into epsilon naught epsilon R upon W. So this is basically your junction capacitance, or you can say it's basically your epsilon A upon W farad. So this is basically the junction capacitance. So from here we can say the CJ, so we can say that the depletion layer's edges work as parallel plate of a parallel plate capacitor. So this basically junction basically is analogous to a parallel plate capacitor, where the edges of the depletion region act as the two parallel plates of a parallel plate capacitor. So from here we can say Cj is proportional to the area and Cj is inversely proportional to the width of the depletion region. Okay, Cj needs to be, Cj is generally small, is very very small, it's of the order of picofarad, that is basically 10 to the power minus 12 farad. And Cj, so there are two types of junction capacitance. First one is the transition capacitance, second one is basically your depletion capacitance. Okay, that's all folks, I'm stopping this lecture here. Hope to see you in the next lecture with all your concepts clear. So with all the concepts clear, if you have any doubt, please write down in the comment section below and try to solve many more questions based on these concepts which I covered. Otherwise you will not be able to keep a track of what you are going to cover or what you had covered before, Anna. So please be well versed with the concepts. Thank you very much.